Our first guest is Alvin S. Felzenberg, who is an American presidential historian, political commentator, and public official. He was principal spokesman for the 9/11 Commission and is currently the Director of Communications for the Joint Economic Committee for the United States Congress. He teaches at the Annenberg School for Communication at the University of Pennsylvania. He is the author of several books, including Keys to a Successful Presidency, and is a regular contributor to U.S. News and World Report and to the National Review. Speaking of National Review, our second guest, Rich Lowry, rose to the editorship of National Review at the age of 29 and has now held the position for two decades. He is a syndicated columnist, a commentator for Fox News, and a prominent admirer of Abraham Lincoln. He writes for Politico and often appears on Meet the Press and This Week with George Stephanopoulos. I think I pronounced that name correctly. let's welcome our two guests this evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. Bill Buckley would just be so delighted over the Buckley program, especially over the essay contest. I'm a big fan of essays contests because I actually was first noticed at National Review shortly after I graduated when I entered a young writers contest at NR, and I technically finished tied for second, which colleagues will occasionally tell me to bring me down a notch. Really means I finished third. it's a pleasure to be here. And Al, congratulations on your book. Al, like I was captivated by Bill Buckley in his prime. When I was a high school student, I discovered Bill through his public affairs program, Firing Line. And it was through Firing Line that I went on to discover National Review. And I would actually smuggle copies of National Review into my classrooms and read it in class, hidden in my textbooks. So what Playboy magazine was to most teenagers my age, National Review was to me. And I would watch religiously Firing Line. I would record it on the VCR, which is kind of an archaic recording device, if any of you curious what that is. But I'd actually rewind to watch difficult bits of it and make sure I understood every word, or at least tried to understand every word. So in short, I wasn't a very popular or well-adjusted teenager, but that's my problem. But it's been the honor of a lifetime to actually work at National Review. And shortly after Bill selected me as editor, he drove me from Stamford, his home there, to his ancestral home, Great Elm in Connecticut, to share Thanksgiving with the rest of the Buckley clan. And Al doesn't get into this in his book, but Bill may have been many things, you know, masterful writer and novelist and a sailor and a harpsichordist, but he couldn't drive worth a damn. And he had this old, huge station wagon. And like many great men, he just had the sense that nothing really could go wrong or harm him. So it was one of the most harrowing rides I've ever had in my life, and in the dark, in the single lane roads. And I remember thinking on the way there, so this is either I've been selected for the honor of a lifetime, or I've stumbled into a bizarre plot to assassinate me. But I did safely make it to Great Elm and had the pleasure and honor of working closely with Bill for years, and he would be delighted over Al's excellent book, which is a labor of love and a significant contribution to the literature on Bill Buckley, focusing on his relationships with Republican presidents. And Al, maybe just to get us started, you would like to tell us a little bit about how you became captivated by Bill Buckley and kind of what your relationship was with him and what the seed was for this book.
All right, let me start with a couple of thank yous. Thank you to William F. Buckley Jr. for living such a glorious life that was very much worth the living and a great deal of fun retelling. And without him, there'd be no book here. I want to thank the William F. Buckley program at Yale. I must tell you that over the decades, I must have taught maybe 20 or 40 seminars, lecture classes, what have you. Back in the 2010-2011 academic year, I taught a student-initiated seminar on the life and times of William F. Buckley, Jr. And out of that class, several students decided to create this program. Look, I'm proud of all I've done, but I can never tell you that I've taught a class that actually led to the founding of a great institution. So I want to thank Lauren. I want to thank everyone else who's associated with the program. Noah and Zach in the back and some faces I can't recognize. Well, about 5, 6, 7, 8 years before, around the, I guess before Rich was smuggling National Review into biology class, all right, when other kids were lining up to see the Beatles, which I did too, I must admit, I wasn't completely out of it, but my generation, but a little bit out of it. I was lining up to hear William F. Buckley Jr. speak at Montclair State High School. Can you imagine that? In the high school, it was affiliated with Montclair State College. He would come very, very often. I think I still have the ticket for the entrance in 1968, somewhere in my souvenirs. He came into my life when I was watching television one day. My family never ran for public office, but they were certainly interested in public affairs. And there was a newspaper strike in New York City, so most of that means television was going to cover the void. And here is this fellow, not like any politician I'd ever seen in my life, having a press conference. And the first question was, what do you intend to do if you're elected mayor? And he would say something like, well, I would demand a recount. And he would say, why don't you ask him why I'm running for mayor? Well, so here he is directing, producing the entire show. All right. Well, those of you interested in politics, public affairs, world of the media, I always tell people, take a chance. Take a risk. You never know what's going to happen. Well, he ran for mayor, not because he had a ghost of a prayer of becoming mayor, but here was a chance to showcase some conservative ideas that have been kicking around in the back pages of the magazine and some other things that were going on. Milton Friedman's economics and incentives, negative income tax, welfare reform, even some ideas about how to improve the New York City taxi situation that you would know as Uber. Were part of his plan. Like, why can't any driver without a criminal record rent out space in his private property, car? Well, this is the beginning of the concept. He ran for mayor to showcase it. Well, showcase it where? Showcase it in the most liberal city in America, where we knew he didn't have any chance. But he knew the media would carry it. He also was not, deliberately not, America's idea of a conservative. They were supposed to be stodgy, boring, old. Buckley himself called them the nothing against the National Association of Manufacturers type, but he used to say, I'm just not one of those breeds. They didn't fly airplanes, they didn't go sailing, they didn't go skiing, they didn't drive rich to their home and take their life and his life in their hands.
I might have preferred if they had driven me to Buckley.
So here was this weird character where in every possible way would have been, you know, the quintessential liberal, except that he thought odd things, is now the nation's most famous conservative. Well, as a result of that campaign, about 3 months later, he's offered a chance to go on television. What did I say earlier? The print media went dark for several weeks in the middle of a campaign. Television carried the ball, and here was a telegenic, brilliant debater. And he was offered a show by, of all things, it was not PBS yet. Interesting, PBS had been singing the same song for how long? Save us, save us, save us. You know, whether times are good or times are bad, save us, save us, save us, they're doing this now. He started with a local New York show, I think it was WOR, RKO, I think the company's still around. And within about 6 months in the coming of the Nixon administration, it moves to PBS so they can tell some of their budget critics on Capitol Hill, that, see, we do have conservative programming. We do have William F. Buckley Jr., right? And then they would name like 10 other liberal shows, but we have William F. Buckley Jr. And then I would sit there and say, yeah, I have William F. Buckley Jr. And half the show is promoting some liberal, but to get Buckley, you have to watch the whole hour and get him for half the time. Okay. So during this period, I'd never seen a guy like this in my life. So I started writing to him. You know, I had a question about this. I don't know how I got the gall to do this. I never wrote anybody like that before. I saw this in your column and didn't understand X and Y, and he'd answer you. Wow. Why is he answering me? I mean, if I wrote James Reston, he would say, how many people write to me? I mean, thousands. And he answered me. So I wrote him again and again. And finally, I asked if I could meet him. And I did, and you'll remember your wonderful, wonderful Secretary for National Review is Frances Bronson. And my image of her was always on the phone with a receiver and a cigarette in each hand. I mean, constant. It got so bad that she started wearing a turban, a Dolly Madison turban, because she said she didn't have time to take care of hairdressers and all that. Anyway, so I'd be begging her for an appointment every now and then, and she would always try to make herself so unpleasant on the phone, like maybe I'd go away, right? You know, and when she'd give you what you want, she wouldn't say goodbye. And I would sit there, hello, did she just said I could come in tomorrow at 3 o'clock? Goodbye, hello. So I kind of got used to that, a bit of an obstacle. But you know, these 3 or 5 minute sessions went on for some time and a friendship formed. I won't say I was one of his intimates, I won't say I was part of his world at National Review, but I certainly was a fellow traveler. I plead complete guilty to that. And why don't I yield back to Richard. That's how he came into my life. And I thought this was an extraordinary book to write. I mean, you'll decide how good it is, it's a book, but an extraordinary opportunity, because here is a man that dominated every form of communications. That's my other field, which I teach at Penn. Every form of communication in his time. Print, radio, television. Boy, television. Interesting, the 10 years apart. I knew him, again, television. I knew him when he ran for mayor. You were interested in firing line, and then that got you to the magazine. Television, the great, in my time and your time, a great way of getting on the national scene. There are many people who write beautiful things and they don't have a national following the way he had. Okay, national following. Television leads to speaking appearances. Speaking appearances lead to campuses. He did about 70 campuses a year in his heyday. He was the most sought after speaker on American colleges and universities, even though students probably had complete contempt for his ideas. And he's the one they wanted to have a beer with after the lecture. Fascinating. They would agree with Arthur Schlesinger, but who wants to have a drink with him, right? Reminds me what Obama said about Mitch McConnell. You know, you think I'm doing badly with Congress? You have coffee with Mitch McConnell. Well, that's sort of their view about Schlesinger and some of these other guys. He might agree with us on things, but Buckley's the one we want to go out and have a beer with. So, all right, that's how the book was formed. It took about 7 years because he left the most voluminous papers behind, 5,000 boxes, probably more. These are the private papers. I mean, the public record. We have the 50-something books. We have 5,000 columns. We have 1,300. Taped interviews and debates, but then we have 5,000 boxes of letters and photographs and other things he did. It's an extraordinary life.
So 5,000 boxes.
Boxes.
5,000 boxes.
What did I say?
Not 5,000 letters.
No,
5,000 boxes.
5,000 boxes, which probably gets the letters probably to the millions.
Yeah, there's a scholar who apparently estimates that Bill Buckley may have written more letters than anyone in American history.
I would think that's right, and they all read. You know, the man. I don't know how he found the time. The letters are with such lucid prose as if he was worrying for writing a column. He was writing for one person. And the number of people he had was endless correspondence with. Some of them live 5 blocks away, like Norman Mailer. I don't know how he found the time for that. Or the time for people like me, which is fascinating. That was what I found most fascinating about him as a human being. Generosity that he displayed with his time, with his support, with all kinds of things. Many things went done anonymously.
So let's dive in. First of all, your point to how many different forms of media he dominated, it's hard to understand just how dominant a figure he was. I mean, he was the foremost conservative columnist, sort of like George Will is today, one of the most important public affairs interviewers in the country. So he was sort of like Tim Russert in his heyday. The most important conservative popularizer, so like Rush Limbaugh in a way, you know, a conservative author who's writing bestsellers, you know, every year or two, so kind of like Bill O'Reilly in that respect, all kind of in one ball. And the speaking itself would have been enough to run any normal person into the ground. So Al says, you know, 70 college speeches a year. He wrote about this for The New Yorker when he finally stopped giving speeches, and he wrote about this episode where his practice was, you know, he in order to live such a full life, you have to have everything planned to the T. and everything down to a routine. And he had a routine where he would have a file folder in his briefcase when he was giving a speech at a college, and he would work on the flight, and then when the flight was landing, he would open the file folder and say, oh, here, I'm going to X university and meeting, you know, this person, et cetera. And so this flight was landing some school somewhere. He opened the file folder, and the page described telling him what school it was missing. So he's picked up by, you know, a bright student, and during the dinner and the reception and the speech, he's hoping someone will say the name of the school. He doesn't want to ask anyone. And then, you know, the next morning, you know, he gets on the flight to go do his next thing, and he meant always to check, and he never did. So he wrote about the New Yorker, saying, I gave the speech at a college, and I don't know what the college was. And someone wrote to him, saw that, and wrote to him, remember seeing that event, and told him what the school was. I forget what it is now. But so, Al, let's start at the beginning with Eisenhower.
Yes.
And your chapter on Dwight Eisenhower is comforting for me at this moment, because it's a reminder that National Review has a long and storied history of ineffectually opposing ideologically suspect Republican presidents.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about Buckley and Eisenhower.
Well, let me first say one quick thing about Buckley's childhood. I won't say much, but if you all came from homes the way I did, you know, your parents teach you very early. The word for this in psychology is socialization, right? You want to get along with other children. You're going to have to learn to compromise once in a while. You can't always get your way. You're going to have to bend occasionally. You're going to have to adapt. You're going to have to and he was of the kind that said, the hell with that. You know, I'm going to spend my life bringing the world to my point of view. It might take longer. I might be less popular. They might say I'm weird, but that's the way it's going to be. Now, this tremendous self-confidence came from the parents, which we can talk about or you can read about, and the fact that he had 9 siblings who thought he was perfect and shared every one of his views, which in those days were his parents' views. And whenever Buckley would do anything, the entire family would get engaged in it. One quick story. When you wanted to try out for the Yale Daily News, when you're a freshman and you come in, and I think you have to go out for second semester, a freshman year or first semester, sophomore year, one of them. Those days, you had to have points. You had to have points for the number of stories you filed. And they split this role, but you had to have points for the number of ads you placed. And at the end of the time, they add these things up and you're interviewed, and at the end of all this, you get picked or not picked. Well, the entire family went to work on this. So, you know, what could some of them do who weren't based nearby, didn't go to Yale? Well, he did have 6 sisters. And they all went to schools, very, very nice women's schools, whether they were Smith or Vassar or you name it. And they all started selling ads for the Yale Daily News to what? To dress shops in the towns they were going to school in. Now, think about this. Yale was a school for men. And if any of the Yale men wanted to buy a gift for their girlfriend or for their mother or their sister, they might go down the street, they might be going to New York, but they're not going to go to Northampton, Massachusetts to do it. But of course, Mrs. Buckley had an account, and there were 6 sisters. And you want to keep the business, you want to keep the account. Eisenhower is very part of this. Because we're having a battle now. Where does the movement stop, and where does the Republican Party come in? Well, they're fellow travelers, as I said about myself, but they're not necessarily the same. And most Republicans, particularly Buckley's kind of Republicans, after 20 years of Franklin Roosevelt and Harry Truman, many conservatives felt the time's come now that the war is now over. The Depression is now over, but you wouldn't know it from the Democrats. They're always having a program to fight a depression, whether half the country's unemployed or 4% unemployed, they have 100 new programs. And you've seen this from Obama, you know. Roosevelt begot Truman, Truman begot Johnson, and Johnson got me, and I'm going to give you health care whether you want it or not, whether you know you can afford it or not. That's the program. Well, here was our chance, right? We won the war, and everybody's now returning, and so we're going to do some things Republicans have been fighting to do for decades. Repeal the New Deal, or at least slow it down. Reduce the size of government. These arguments never go away. And on foreign policy, Soviets had a field day, as you know. The war was over. We had these marches welcoming the GI's home down Times Square and other places. And the Russian Soviet soldiers stayed in place, right? We're protecting our barriers, our boundaries, we're protecting our borders. Well, Eisenhower and Dulles were expected by many people to start putting pressure on the Soviets to withdraw. Economic pressure, military pressure, propaganda pressure, and all the rest of it. Well, very early, Buckley figures out that's not going to happen. Well, and that's the momentum for the magazine. Because the magazine is, we're more than Republicans. You know, we could have just taken the Dewey-Truman race and said Dewey came so close. All we have to do is add the soldier vote, and we'd have a Republican president. And that was very happy. That's what the establishment wanted. Everything's fine. Now we are in power. And maybe we'll have a better tax cut for big business or this and that, by the way, which he hated. He talked about corporate welfare as early as the 1950s. He talked about free trade long before Eisenhower got there, but Eisenhower did become a free trader. So he decides that much as I lamented, the conservatives are now going to go into opposition. And we're going to find a way of getting all the conservatives, by the way, what were conservatives? It wasn't much of a movement. There were feuding factions, as James Madison would say, that didn't have much in common with each other. On the one hand, you had the Southern conservative Democrats. They were characterized obviously by segregation, but also opposition to labor unions. So we had right-to-work states, but we also had the segregation, which we can talk about. And then we had the Midwesterners, and they were protection. Oh, by the way, the Southerners were the free traders, many of them, not all of them. And then you had the Midwesterners, who were symbolized by Buckley's, I would call, beau ideal of a statesman, Robert Taft. They wanted to be neutral, or at least stay out of the war until Pearl Harbor came, but they wanted to withdraw to a simpler kind of America afterward. They didn't want to have what Eisenhower himself would call, you know, the standing military-industrial complex that would look for ways to test weaponry, and often that means engaging troops half a continent away or more. But they were isolationists. They were farm states. They had nothing in common with the segregationists. They had very little in common with trade. They might have agreed about labor unions. And then you had, you know, what we called traditionalists. The people who believed that there was an American conservative tradition on the European model. When you think of the British Tory Party, you think of Burke, you think of Watt, you think of the church, you think of the landed aristocracy, you think of the university. Isn't that a joke, given what's going on over there and over here? They were part of the natural ruling elite, conservative elite. Okay. So there wasn't much of a movement here. So he said, well, whatever there is, we're going to create our own, and they need a place to go. And I'm going to build that place. I'm going to call it National Review. And we're going to have a certain synergy going on where we're going to think of what do we agree on before we don't let all these things that Felzenberg just described tear us apart. What do we agree on? Well, we all agree about Joseph Stalin. Oh, by the way, I left out the libertarians. And they were beginning to form. And, you know, Ayn Rand will air her head somewhere in the 50s. But there was a libertarian strain out there. And he said, okay, what do we agree on? Well, we all agree that Stalin's a bad guy, and if he prevails, we're all dead together. So that's one thing we can talk about. We agree about taxes, perhaps. We might agree about tax cuts. We might agree about local control, perhaps states' rights and other things. And he starts the magazine. He writes the most, of all the presidents, you would think, if I were to stand on it, go to CPAC and say, all right, show of hands, which president do you think Buckley would have been the most critical of, the most bitter about, the most cynical toward? Well, some might say Clinton, some might say Johnson, some might say Kennedy. No, it was Ike. Ike. Well, the party thought he was crazy. I say that for that reason. You know, it took us 20 years to win the White House. We got a two-term winner. And this guy isn't happy. Okay, now what is wrong with you? Okay? So in Eisenhower's image, a number of state parties get moving and they start nominating moderate Republicans. And Buckley gets the idea that early in the 50s that perhaps we need a conservative party. to compete with Republicans and Democrats, as he will do when he runs for mayor, okay? One last point on this, which gets us back to our current president. There's been a great debate in the Democratic Party, too, but primarily on our side, the conservative side. What's the best way to get a majority? Well, given the fact that the country is divided, most ways to get a majority in a realigning era, which we're probably going through, get Democrats to vote for you. Get the other party to come over, as Ronald Reagan proved, and you build a new majority. Well, there's one way to do that that Eisenhower and the like tried. And this was the time Richard Hofstadter, great historian of the period, called the Great Liberal Consensus. Well, I like to think of it as the Great Moderate Consensus, or George Wallace basically said that consensus means there's not a dime worth of difference between the Republicans and the Democrats. Yeah. If we act like Democrats, we might get Democrats to vote for us. So if you go back and you study the speeches and the issues between Stevenson and Eisenhower, they were not very far apart on the issues, or for that matter, Kennedy and Nixon in 1960. The difference of personality, difference were traditional party allegiances and all of that. Well, it worked sometimes. Nelson Rockefeller was governor of New York four times. His record was virtually indistinguishable from a Democrat. But then you have the other approach that takes longer. You have the Reagan approach, and I'm going to win a different kind of Democrat. I'm going to win Democrats like me in California that feel that the bureaucracy in California is not representing them. And so, you know, whether we like it or don't like it, Trump found a way to say, I'm going to get the votes of alienated Democrats that don't feel Obama's represented them, and I can go county after county after county. Where Obama won it twice. And this is, to some extent, what the theme of Hillbilly Elegy is about, the book that everybody is reading after the election, of course, not before. When I mean everybody, I mean the media. There's no reason you should waste your time with it. But the point I'm making here is there are two ways to do it, and he came up with this one. The way to do it is to realign the Republican Party by making it the instrument of all conservatives, and that becomes the Goldwater campaign. Let me stop. I'll have shorter answers as we go.
So, yes,
that's shorter.
So Eisenhower, with Eisenhower, Buckley was really on the outside, and he was sort of just inveighing against the current order of things. With President Nixon, you begin to see him entering the circles of power. So who was, they both wanted Nixon and Buckley something from the other.
Yes.
Who was playing whom in that relationship?
Well, okay. In the run-up to the 1968 convention, you had Rockefeller we talked about, but in terms of the conservatives, you had a great debate between Reagan and Nixon. Who should be our champion? Buckley took the view, you know, we just nominated Barry Goldwater, and we took the party over, the most conservative person in history. If we run Ronald Reagan, who's only been in office for a year, I guess he hadn't heard about the coming of Barack Obama yet, but and we lose this one, and we lose this one on a question of experience, our movement's going to be dead. So the next choice, remember the line about the most viable conservative around there? Well, we're not going to be in Rockefeller, not conservative, might be viable. Reagan's conservative and may not get elected. Well, I'm going to make some deals with Nixon. And I'm also, whether Nixon likes it or not, wants it or not, my service to Nixon is going to be to completely discredit, this is very relevant to now, completely discredit George Wallace as a conservative force. I'm going to expose him as a racist. I'm going to expose him as a fraud. And I'm going to make it impossible for any self-regarding conservative to vote for him. Wallace was claiming that he is the law and order candidate. He's going to stand up to rioters. He's going to enforce laws. He talked about pointy-handed bureaucrats with their briefcases in Washington, D.C., telling us why to run our lives and all that. He was the guy who stood in the schoolhouse door to stop Southern blacks from getting admission. Bottom line here, I'm going to stop with this. Buckley destroys Wallace. He puts him on firing line. And it wasn't just the one show. He stays on this guy's tail for the next year. Puts him on firing line and says, you're not a conservative, sir. You're nothing but a welfare populist. What do you mean welfare populist? You love every Washington program, except those that benefit African Americans. Well, I don't want any of these programs. Now I'm going to tick off my audience, right? I don't want Medicare. I don't want aid to education. I don't want the rest of the great society. But you know, if you're going to have them, you can't discriminate on the basis of race. That's all you're about. You're a fraud, sir. And then he starts going Wallace's budgets. How you hate the federal government? 80% of your budget comes from Washington programs. Well, destroyed the man. That was a great presence for Nixon. He writes an article for Look magazine, basically saying we don't need, you know, we've had it with the Democrats, we've had it with Johnson and Humphrey. We don't have to go here. Mr. Nixon's running on a rather palatable conservative agenda. But that said, when you say you want the lesser evil, at some point, you're living with evil, Immanuel Kant. So Nixon also brought OSHA and EPA and a larger federal government. Above all, Bill was one of the few columnists not to question Nixon's decision to open China to American visitors and trade, but the way he did it, the way Nixon, remember, was the man that exposed communists in the government, the man that was a front man for Shanghai Shang and the the old China lobby, suddenly on a dime is saluting, you know, ballets that glorify Mao Zedong's destruction of our ally in Taiwan. So there's a bit of a break, and then of course it gets to Watergate. Who came out on top? Buckley did. There's this great tape. Well, all these tapes are good if you have a life to read, listen to them, but there's a line in one of the tapes where Nixon's discussing hush money for some of the Watergaters. And there's one who had six children, his wife dies in a plane crash. And Nixon said, well, the guy's a friend of Buckley's. No problem here. We'll just get Bill to write a letter saying, you know, the guy's had hard times and he needs money. Well, this is played now on, you know, ABC and NBC. We have Nixon and Mitchell and others talking about how they're going to deal with Buckley. So a reporter calls Buckley and he says, I would have been very happy to write a column in sympathy of sons of bitches, as Mr. Nixon knows in personal experience, having been pardoned. Yes, he came out on top. He did not sell his soul. Nixon had to pay for that endorsement.
You know, I read with interest the Wallace transcripts a year or so ago when, you know, during the Republican primaries, when Trump, his answer to everything was, one, the polls, including online polls, and two, if you criticized him, you were an egghead, out of touch intellectual. And these are exactly the arguments that Wallace uses with Buckley in these interviews. You know, Buckley says, oh, there's a letter that appeared in Human Events from 300 conservative thinkers and activists, and Wallace, like, I haven't heard any of them. I haven't seen any of those boys down at the courthouse. You know, what do they matter to me? And by the way, there was a poll that a Pittsburgh TV station held of its viewers, and I'm the most popular politician in the country, according to this TV poll. So what do I care about your intellectuals?
Right.
And so these are
very
sort of common
much.
Themes
very
of
much.
Sort of Jacksonian politics that Wallace
very, very much.
And Trump both represent in their different ways. So talk a little bit about Buckley and Reagan. You know, this is the high point of Buckleyite conservatism in America. How important was Buckley's intellectual spade work to that political?
Well, conflict? It's very interesting. The synergy starts in the early 50s when Reagan's career is washed up as an actor, about to take off on television, but not quite there. But he becomes a spokesman for General Electric. And there's a vice president at General Electric that wants to promote free enterprise, student essays on free enterprise, right? Young farmers, future lords of America, future businessmen of America. And Reagan goes out and talks to all these groups. And the vice president says, you know, there's this magazine that I've been looking at, and it's like 8 pages. It comes with a brown paper wrapper. You're going to be crossing the country on train. You might as well read it. And Reagan is now going through the process of converting from conservative Republican to from liberal Democratic conservative Republican. And he starts reading this. And he finds he's in agreement with it, and increasingly so. And he sees, what's this National Review about? And he takes an early subscription to it. And I would say that he was reading Buckley sometime before he met him. But what happens in this course of the relationship, well, actually met, by the way, no issues ever change. Those of you who want to go into politics, you're going to find it never changes. Buckley is now the speaker at an event Reagan is hosting. And the event is to stop John F. Kennedy from passing Medicare, which is a form of socialized medicine in disguise. Buckley is the speaker, and he's invited to come. Well, they're in this restaurant, and they didn't know each other. I mean, Reagan had no idea what Buckley looked like, but the other was true. And the waiter tells Reagan that his speaker is sitting in the corner. So Reagan and Nancy's sister are leaving to go to the hall, and they say, excuse us, Mr. Buckley. And he gets up. Oh, I didn't realize it was you. Da, 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 da. I loved your last book, and I can't stop laughing over your reference to Eleanor Roosevelt in there. Buckley said, and he's thinking immediately, this guy is no dumb actor. This guy is no airhead. This is not my most, it's my most recent, but it's not my most popular book. It's a very obscure joke that I made about Eleanor Roosevelt in the book. Who at that point was, Miss ASPCA, the woman couldn't do anything wrong. And Buckley writes, following Mrs. Roosevelt in search of an inconsistency is like looking at a fuse next to a piece of dynamite. You never have to wait long, you never have to look far. And this is what he remembered. This guy's no dope. So, a correspondence begins, and in the decades, the correspondence goes from, dear Mr. Reagan to dear Ronnie, and it stops at Mr. President. Funny, he never calls him governor, but he does call him president, and he won't stop even after he's out of office. The big surprise, too, is the role of Nancy Reagan. Now, if Ronald Reagan wasn't just their common goal, obviously she was very important in his career, and obviously Bill was, too. But the alliance they formed could have been one heck of a major political consultant firm, called Bill and Nancy. She writes him a letter saying, thank you for your interest in Ronnie's campaign for governor. I know you don't spend your waking hours figuring out all the esoteric issues of Northern California. Don't worry about it, but Ronnie is debating in Northern California. And here's a box of clippings you might want to look at from all the newspapers. I've underlined Ronnie's position. Well, 4 days later, there's a column about it, about what's going on in California. Well, 6 weeks later, there's another one, and another one, and another one. What are we going to do, Bill? Esquire is going to do a hatchet job on Ronnie. And Jessica Mitford's going to write it, and she's a Marxist. She's going to blow him out of the water, and she never forgave him, leaving the Democrats. He goes, no problem. If I can't deep-six the article, see, an editor, he's picking up. If I can't deep-six the article, I will talk the editor out of that writer. So we'll get an article that's not going to get the attention of Jessica Mitford, so they gave it to a sports guy for the LA Times, knew nothing about it, about politics, but they had to pick up the article, he wanted to make some money. That is how close it got behind the scenes. Now, I'm not saying this never happened before, never happened again, but with the Reagans, it happened constantly. Every time the administration is having a PR problem, our current press secretary is having one, right, with the Holocaust and Hitler. Every day there's another one. But Reagan had his episode with Spitberg, which you may have heard about. He had agreed to go to a cemetery in Germany to commemorate the end of the war and the beginning, more importantly, the beginning of the American-German alliance. And it was not known to the advance team that there were some SS Waffen people who were just not draftees and did some horrible things. How does Reagan get out of this? Well, again, Nancy writes to one or two people, and you know who he is, and he puts the storyline out that the President of the United States, having grown up in theater world, always believes the show must go on. However, he gave a speech, and he says, "Well, go to a cemetery, give an eloquent speech, give a speech people will talk about, and not the visit." This is the coaching you're getting. Now, this is not just "I like your tax bill." Right, and all conservatives who stand for something should vote for your tax bill. He did that too. He also wrote Reagan public columns to get his attention, and private letters, and I don't know how many phone harangues, on how he could come up with a stronger tax bill, because what Buckley was afraid of was the Reagan tax bill was phased in over the course of the term, Democrats would say, it's not working, let's kill it, let's repeal it right away. And he's giving Reagan advice. Now, this is beyond advice. Now we're talking political strategy. Now we're talking survival. You'll see it again during Iran-Contra. You'll see it all the way through. You'll even see it when Ronnie writes Bill that Nancy's very blue because the Kitty Kelly book did a number on her. And so he begins to write her and begins to start having to deal with this. And so that's the kind of friendship it was. Christopher said to me that his father, he also wrote it in one of his memoirs, his father obviously was, he thought, the one male friend that could really get close to Reagan, who could get through the Teflon. People will tell you the Reagans were so close as a marriage that there was no space for anybody else, I mean, even the children. But the Buckleys and the Reagans went, they had their own Thanksgivings together. They went snorkeling together. They went on vacations together. When he saw his Hollywood friends, they talk about movies. When he saw Bill, he talked about ideas, and he let his hair down. The only time that I could tell. That was pretty strong.
I remember Bill telling a story, and this goes to Reagan being a man of ideas himself. They were on vacation together, and they were discussing after dinner some aspect of monetary policy and inflation and what the appropriate metric was for inflation. And Bill got tired and bored of this conversation and said, I'm going to bed. And then he woke up the next morning, and Reagan had shoved under his door six pages from a notebook with his further handwritten thoughts on this monetary question. So Reagan was not just dunce who was led around by advisors. He's someone who marinated in conservative thought for decades. So let's bring it down from the highs of Reagan and tell us a little bit about Buckley and the Bushes.
Well, you would think that the Bushes and Buckley would have a lot more in common because they started out in a similar place. I mean, Reagan didn't go to Yale, obviously. He came from very hard scrabble roots and beginnings. Buckley's story, it's a glorious story and an inspiring story, but, it isn't log cabin to riches story. It's a different story. It's a question of growth and evolution, generosity, things I said earlier. So you would think that he would gravitate to the Bushes more. In a way, he did. I mean, socially, he knew George Herbert Walker Bush, longer than he knew Reagan. He made it very clear to George Herbert Walker Bush that he was his choice for president, but that he had a previous commitment. And until Ronnie was running, stop asking, basically. but if he decides he's not going to run, well, then it happens. 1988, he works very hard to get Bush the nomination. In 1980, here's a Yale story. In 1980, when Reagan beats Bush in the primaries. Nick Brady, soccer fame at Yale, also 41, Secretary of the Treasury, calls Bill and said, this is the time, you're close to both of them. If I get Bush to drop out, will you call Ronnie and talk about the ticket? And Bill does this. I'm not saying that's how he got on the ticket. I'm saying that's how close it was, that three people could sit around and say, yeah, we got millions of Republicans out there, but I know George and Ronnie, let's make this happen. Well, he said, I know George and Ronnie, and you only know George. I can help you make it happen. I mean, this is Bill correcting him. Well, it gets off to a good start, but again now, Bill was never one to let personal friendships decide his politics. He was trying to pull Bush, in his way. Supported him greatly on the foreign side, but I will say, he got seared as a young man, 1940. He was part of America First and part of isolationism, all of which he repudiates. Hero of his youth was Felzenberg. And the Republicans nominate Wilkie. And Wilkie runs against Roosevelt, and Mrs. Buckley, his mother, sends $50 to Wendell Wilkie. I don't know what that would be in modern days. And he was crushed. January after the election, Wilkie is testifying in favor of Roosevelt's Lend-Lease program. And he said that, you said you were against helping Britain during the campaign. He said, yeah, but that was campaign rhetoric. And Buckley said, how dare you? How dare you have such contempt for your base? This kid of 15 years old saying that. Imagine that. Well, fast forward, no new taxes. Well, you know, Mr. President, there are a lot of people who believed you. Many voted for you because they believed you. And this really is a betrayal. And you either have to explain it. Now, there could be a reason for national security, where we had to have that money yesterday, or something else. But just to then make fun of your voters by saying, you know, I meant to say, read my hips, look at this. I just found that very contemptuous. With 43, the problem was of a different kind, and we're still living in the aftermath of it. To what extent, in a post-Cold War era, now, by the way, with Ike, he does say one thing of value, that look, he said many things of value, both Buckley and Ike, but for our purposes. Buckley said, we might like Ike, we might not like Ike, but the fact is, fellow conservatives, as long as we have a superpower willing to destroy us and able to destroy us, we're going to have to prioritize some of our objectives. And maybe we're going to have to live with this monster of a federal government until the day comes when we've gotten rid of this threat. Well, that happens under 41. The wall comes down. Leonard Bernstein is having a concert on the wall, all of that. Now we have 43. And at this point, Bill says, you know, we're going to invest American treasure, American lives, to further American interests. If George thinks that Saddam Hussein has weapons of massive destruction, he has every right to go in. And I would rather be embarrassed if he doesn't find them and have millions of lives spared, perhaps, than have millions of lives destroyed because he made a mistake and did not go in. But what is this occupation business? We're not going to invest soldiers' lives so there can be a Baghdad primary of people who don't want to live together. And the only thing they seem to be able to do is try to destroy each other, which is what we're achieving by sitting on them. So if we're going to be there for 70 years, we should talk about it, Mr. President. And he becomes one of the administration's most virulent critics. Now, this has now become a major argument within the Republican Party. To what extent do you use troops and for what purpose? And even from the beginning, Buckley, when he was an isolationist, thought, again, if we were bombed, we were attacked, which we were, then we fight for America and we fight for our allies, and we even have to make deals with the Russians if we have to. But we don't go around, again, we can argue about it. We don't have preemptive war. We don't go to war unless you can identify an American interest. Now, later in life, he did say there was a strategic American interest in going in, which he figured out as an older fellow or middle-aged fellow, and that is if Germany had defeated Britain and the Nazi Navy replaces the British fleet, protecting American shipping, and the Japanese begin to start making headways on the West Coast and driving the Brits out of Malaysia and other places, how secure would those oceans have made it then? But still, what is the American interest? There's a show on right now, which I urge you to watch. This debate starts with a fellow named Woodrow Wilson, so you can blame Princeton and not Yale for a change. Make the world safe for democracy. How do you define it? For who? How many troops? How are we going to make it safe? By example? By conquest? Yes, this is an old battle. And it has reemerged at the end of the Cold War, and it got very bitter between Buckley and principal conservatives, including your magazine, and George Bush. There also were problems with the spending, but Peggy Noonan, who just won a Pulitzer, all right, wrote that if she knew, this is even before 9/11, like 6 months in, if she knew how much George Bush was going to spend, she wouldn't have urged people to vote for him. And Al Gore would have had a better budget. That's her call, not mine, but that's the answer with the Bushes.
So we have about 10 or 15 more minutes. I want to ask you about Buckley and Trump, but maybe it'll come up in the, okay. the Q&A. All right. Questions from the audience.
Do you have any more?
Audience.
Okay. All right. Yeah, I'll bring it in. Okay. Hi.
Any questions? Don't be shy.
This is Yale. You're not supposed to be shy. I mean, you're not throwing anything at me, which is good, but I mean, you can ask questions. Thank you.
Thank you for your talk. What do you think Bill would have thought of Trump and the job he's doing now?
Okay. All right.
There we go.
Thank you. This is really Rich's last question, so I guess you got a plan here. Thank you, sir. Well, it's always dangerous to say what would people not with us say about changing things when they don't know the circumstances. In Bill's case, we know a few things. He did write about Trump in 2000. I wish he had written it in your magazine instead of Cigar Aficionado, because everybody would know about it. And it would be much easier to Google, I must say, but okay. Trump then was on the left. And he was running on a very different platform, but Buckley made the same point. He worried about vanity. That's all he saw was vanity, the whole campaign. He worried about what he called Caesarism, which is, again, a very old conservative principle. You know, if you were to, and this is another problem with Bush, both Bushes. Buckley supported both Iraq invasions both times. He demanded that the president ask Congress for permission to send people's children into harm's way, and not permission from the United Nations, a majority of which is dominated by one-party dictatorships. He thought it was nuts. We're going to ask their permission? We're going to go there to judge our soldiers and human rights? Are you out of your mind? So we know where he stood on that. But Caesarism. You know, when Trump ran, you know, he was going to do all these things. He never said, you know, I'm going to ask Congress to come up with an infrastructure plan. I'm going to ask Congress to reform health care. Well, it was all me, me, me. He didn't like that. And he thought, again, the idea of judges being attacked. Buckley attacked lots of judges. But there's a chapter where, you know, he didn't like a lot of opinions of the Earl Warren Court. Obviously not. If you think about the tenets of the magazine, how could he support most of the Warren Court? But he didn't want to impeach judges. I mean, the way to deal with that was to get a president like Nixon, right, to have somebody who at least claims to be a strict constructionist in his reading of the Constitution. You just don't, you know, send a chariot down Pennsylvania Avenue and drag Earl Warren through the streets. He hasn't done anything illegal. And if you didn't like the president's choice, you know, get a better president or lobby the president, or you get it. So the contemporary institutions bothered him then, would probably bother him now. The coarsening of the culture. One thing about Buckley, don't be upset if you can't resolve it. He never could. There's a tension between elitism and populism, which we know. I mean, when elites get out of line, they have in the past, Jackson wasn't the only one, even the patrician Franklin Roosevelt was talking about robber barons in Wall Street, you know. There's a way to do it. One way is the George Wallace way, and the other way is by having reform. We are a republic, we're not a democracy. The idea of doing it through the streets, the idea of intimidating people by the size of crowds, or making up your own facts. Boy, he hated the liberal media, but I mean, they could agree sometimes on certain facts, and he didn't like their spin on it, but they would argue things. But we have that much. So in Buckley's life, you know, at Yale, you don't like the curriculum, well, then you have trustee elections. Well, it sounds populist, except it's an odd form of populari, because they all have Yale degrees, they're very homogenous. Well, when you want to deal with the communists in the State Department, and you think Truman and Ike are hiding files from Congress, well, then you take it to the public, and suddenly the polls show we want security tightened and all right, that's more perhaps populist. But he also talked about the tablet keeper. You know, if he was going to write certain extremists, racists, bigots out of the movement, you need a movement that you can control. And if you're going to excommunicate somebody, you have to have a pope, right? And so what he really wanted, you know, the line that he always used is about, you'd rather be governed by the first 200 names in the Boston phone book than the first 200 names in the Harvard faculty. But what he really wanted was a conservative faculty. He really wanted was a conservative elite, which dawned on me the more I got into it. Because as a young man, he wrote a term paper at prep school on post-war Germany, and some plans that were being debated. And Secretary Morgenthau wanted it to be an agricultural country so they can't use their industrial might a third time, and other people wanted to divide it up. Mrs. Thatcher said she wants as many Germanys as she could get. Why didn't we stop at two? All right, there were debates. Okay, well, she lived through the war. She lived through the bombing. So there were memories. He writes to his headmaster, you know, I'm not so sure about this denazification stuff. I hope it works. But every time I go to the movies on Saturday, they show these newsreels, and these people look pretty happy to me. These Nuremberg mobs do not seem coerced. And of course, Wallace terrified him. We don't have time to get into it, but his parents were Southern. And again, everything about Southern politics is not always black and white. I mean, literally and figuratively, not always that way. Here's a case where, let's say the Bourbon, Southern Bourbon segregationists, Senator Thurman, maybe, some others, they might have not wanted integration, but they were certainly opponents of the Ku Klux Klan and the violence, okay? Now, Thurman found a way to survive. Well, he was one of a kind, but the others were suddenly defeated in runoff primaries, and the argument was that they weren't doing enough to suppress blacks. And that's the argument Wallace used to supplant these people. So by the time Kennedy comes in, you got a different crowd of Southern governors than you had earlier. And now we got some real problems. Now we have church bombings. Now we have three missing civil rights. I mean, it's appalled him. But times changed, you see. And so he was terrified of the mob, terrified of politics in the street being made by emotion. He never got over that. But he never reconciled that. It was basic anti-elitism, because he didn't like to be told here what books are politically correct, what speech would be tolerated, what would be on a final exam, who'd be teaching in the economics department, whether conservative students were upset about that or not. So he never resolved it. But that's the answer, at least as to where he was. Now, if Trump is, back to your institutional history of magazine, if Trump is changing his tune on NAFTA, if he wants it fine-tuned and not repealed, well, Buck would be fine with that. He had a whole issue on this. Stood up to National Review donors who were threatening to pull multi-$1,000 checks. Look, this is what we think. We're free traders. The magazine's not for sale. Well, he'd have to support that. He probably would have supported a one-time thing in Syria. I don't know. It's very hard to do. But we know what he thought about Caesarism. We know what he thought about vulgarity. And that's about as far as we can go, I think.
Yeah, he's had a very, on top of everything else, a very idiosyncratic mind. So it's really hard to say what he would think about any contemporary matter, except for it's very hard to believe they wouldn't be personally appalled by Trump. And my best sort of contemporary indicator of where Buckley would be on something is probably George Will.
Yeah.
You look at what George Will is saying about Trump, and it's probably a pretty good approximation of where Bill would be.
A great deal of courage, Mr. Will.
And it's not positive.
And I will say Will showed tremendous courage in doing that. He was fired by Fox, as you know. I'll say your magazine did great service to the country. I don't care how many subscribers you get. I mean, Trump thinks you should be competing with National Enquirer, right? You mentioned Wallace before. It was the same thing. But you devote an entire issue to various conservatives, all of whom disagreed on many things. And what do they think of this phenomenon? Buckley did a very similar thing about the John Birch Society, which we don't have time to get into. We can talk later. Anybody else? Yes, please.
So we've talked a little bit about sort of the John Birch Society and George Wallace and the people that Buckley pushed out of the conservative movement, and also groups that Buckley included in the conservative movement and saw a common ground with. And leaving aside Trump the man for a moment, I'd like to ask about Trump the movement and
populism
on the right in general. Do you think that Buckley would have seen, and more generally, just what are your thoughts on whether populism on the right is something that should be brought into sort of a conservative movement?
That's a brilliant question, sir. I hope you write an essay on this yourself. I have a student at Penn said, were we better off leaving these, he called them skinheads with websites, but all right, that's what he called them. But we better leaving them underground where the snakes and the lizards are hanging around in the sewer than bringing them to the open. Well, you had this white, I was furious about this white supremacist, before we even go to Milo, you know about that story, but this white supremacist from Northern Virginia decides that he's going to have a speech, and the GSA under Barack Obama lent him the Reagan building to give a racist speech. It's government property. You have every right to say that this is where the Red Cross has its charity balls and the ASPCA and the NAACP and causes we have it proved. You're not going in here. And they did. They had, so they had 2,000 people and they were all doing this Heil thing. Not all, a couple who saw that on television. Appalling. So my student says it would be better to bring... well, we dissect this like a frog, if that's still allowed. The animal rights groups.
Is Pepe the frog?
Are we allowed to dissect frogs on campus? Or, I don't know. Probably National Geographic movies. But all right. Let's dissect it. He would have been appalled at Hillary Clinton's comment about any American is a deplorable human being because they're voting. I mean, absolutely appalled at that. He would say, we have to take a case to them. Okay? I mean, they're not to blame because they're unemployed and they're angry and things are happening. They have a lot to say. And to the shock of National Review and the Conservative Party, he did better in working class wards when he ran for mayor than he did among Yale alumni. I said he got the votes of more Fordham people than he did Yale people, and the votes of people more who didn't go to college. Did better among the cabbies than did among stockbrokers. You figure that one out. Okay. So he would have said that much. He would have said, if you're based on, and he did say this one a lot, if you're based on a creed that talk about ethnicity and superiority and nationalism, we don't want you. He did say that. Now, if you believe, this goes back to God in a minute, you know, if you believe the same principles we adhere to, we don't care what your background is, we don't care what your religion is, all things should be taught, but they should also be taught that some things are superior. You follow me? I mean, some things are superior to others. This is what got him into trouble a lot, especially here. But East is better than West. Why? Not racially. It's better because we are a Judeo-Christian society. And while we welcome Islam, we welcome Hindi, we welcome all religions, no religions. The fact is the common denominator of the founding fathers was the notion that we were created in God's image, and that's why we can have democracy, and that's why we treat each other equally. If you want to buy in, that's great, but that is a Western creed. You can buy in, and you don't have to have a racial test for that. That's what he'd say. So I think he'd be appalled at these racist stuff. He certainly would not buy anything Milo says, even before he fell. And he would say that both parties have ignored their base. He said that when he was with us. I don't think he would have much traffic with the things Bannon is often accused of doing or saying before he joined the White House. To our president's credit, I don't know what this tells you, but Cruz was accused in Iowa of talking code word in one of the debates when he talked about New York values, okay? Cruz is not, known for being, much of a fundamentalist, but he decided they were fundamentalists in Iowa, therefore he's going to tell them that New York values might imply certain things you don't like. And Trump got up, and first thing he said was, well, I'll talk about New York values, talked about 9/11. Well, then Cruz wasn't done yet, so he comes back and says, there aren't too many conservatives running around New York City. And then he was ready. He said, well, there was William F. Buckley Jr. who did it pretty well. Now,
it's like the one thing he knew about Bill Buckley is lived in New York.
Yeah, that's the only thing he knew.
I'll say, I don't know what Bill would think about this. Of course, he'd excoriate and hate the racists, but Trump is not an alt-right figure. He doesn't know, who any of these people are. And I think just populism is part of the idiom of American politics. You go back to the start of the American Congress, and there are people running against the dandies who are in Congress, and people appalled that there are people in Congress who could barely write their names.
That's right.
And you just look at recent American politics, George H.W., George W. Bush beat Al Gore and beat John Kerry in part because he was more populist than
That's
both
right.
of them.
That's
Barack
right.
Obama beat John McCain and Mitt Romney in part because he was more populist than both of them. And Trump runs a more populist campaign than Hillary Clinton, and lo and behold, he wins a lot of working class Obama voters.
Yep.
And I think the Republican Party has been overinvested in the entrepreneurial ideal. Most entrepreneurs are important, but most people aren't entrepreneurs. And the Trump phenomenon points the way, potentially, you know, there are a lot of pitfalls, but potentially to a more grounded Republican Party that has more connected to the interests of working class voters and potentially has a broader policy portfolio than just marginal income tax rate cuts. And this is a party that in a lot of respects, and you saw it with Rubio and Cruz in the primary campaign last year, that is just living in, rhetorically and in terms of policy in the 1980s,
right.
which was a very, very long time ago for most people. And Republicans, a lot of conservatives just took it for granted. We had this sturdy House of Reagan, it was gonna stand forever. And then this big bad wolf, you know, Donald Trump shows up and he huffs and he puffs and he really blows the thing down. Without, he didn't pay any, repeat any Reaganite phrases. He didn't really endorse any Reaganite policy. You know, the tax cuts, but that wasn't a big part of his appeal. And he showed there's a different way for the Republican Party and potentially, you know, if some of the excesses are shorn off, a better way. But my worst case scenario is that Trump fails. He discredits this kind of working class Republicanism. And the natural instinct of the party is to snap back into the old kind of establishment rut. And for me, that would represent the worst of both worlds.
I think that's very right. I would agree with you.
I think we have time for maybe one more quick question.
I was curious.
Yeah.
We know Buckley had a very close relationship with the Republican presidents of the 20th century, but I'm curious to know if he had meaningful relationships with any of the Democratic presidents.
That's interesting. One of the big surprises in my book. I'll answer you directly. On the policy side, Buckley was rather famous for breaking ranks. He broke ranks with many of the Republicans by supporting the Panama Canal treaties under Jimmy Carter. Buckley becomes, as he did to legitimate Nixon with conservatives, he's now making it safe for Republican senators to vote for the Panama Canal Treaty. The one time in his life he disagreed with Reagan quite visibly was during, they had a tour debate on the Panama Canal. You had Buckley and George Will, and I forgot the third one on one side, and Pat Buchanan, and again, I forget the others. I've written it down. There wasn't any rapport with Jimmy Carter. There certainly was no rapport with Bill Clinton. In fact, one of my great lines about Buckley, he didn't like what Theodore Roosevelt called weasel words. Okay, a weasel word means I'm going to tell you something that you're on the right, you're on the left, you're both going to find something to take home. You might get disappointed with me, but I'm going to be your shyster. So when Clinton said I'm going to reform welfare as we know it, okay? Those on the right heard reform it, and but there was this out to the other side, as we know it, means, well, he's not going to do very much, right? Well, I want to get rid of it. Well, okay. That's weasel word. So he really went to town. He said, look, what he does with his wife is his problem, or more likely hers. He didn't know about Monica. We're still with Jennifer here. We're still with Jennifer Flowers. Monica's like 7 years coming attractions. All right, but you know, I don't care about Jennifer Flowers. All right, and maybe we should ask about it. I don't like the weasel word on welfare. Okay, he said that. But he said, what I don't understand is who he's buying off with his comment about marijuana. And he said, one, he didn't violate the laws of the United States. Well, thank you, thank you, thank you. It was not legal in London when he smoked it, that he smoked it. He said he smoked it and he didn't inhale. And why the hell did he smoke it for? This is Buckley, right. Yeah, I mean, he said, who's going to vote for him because he didn't inhale? He's going to give the Puritans something? What's wrong with this guy? He gave him a pass on Vietnam because he said, you know, Nixon and Kissinger decided they weren't going to win the war, and therefore I can't tell a young man with all conscience that he's fighting for his country when you have a president that is not going to win this thing. He's just going to drag it out to the election. And I'll even give Clinton that. I'll say that his letter showed a great deal of moxie and political strength. Now, the one president I was surprised, he showed great sympathy for the dilemma that Lyndon Johnson got into. There's no relationship I could find between Buckley and Johnson, although I did find that Johnson read his columns. This is why it's called Men and His Presidents. Johnson certainly knew what he was saying. And when Buckley would ever say anything nice about anything Johnson was doing, like he said it to the whole cabinet, like let's march. You got this guy to help us, right? All right. But Buckley said, number one, the left would do Johnson in, not the right. Well, the right because we can't even do anybody in, but the left because they are going to push the old-time socialism after he passes voting rights. They're going to keep quiet on the war. They're going to let him get in deeper and deeper and deeper. You're not going to hear a peep from them until the voting rights bill is done. And then he says, Johnson's major rival is going to be Bobby Kennedy. The only thing I don't know was whether he's going to oppose the president from the right or from the left. But I can tell you, whatever Johnson does, Kennedy will do the opposite. And then he writes about Johnson's broken heart, that here's a guy who passes 1,000 bills. Nobody likes him, right? And nothing is better. There's no heaven on earth. We were going to wipe out poverty. We were going to wipe out illiteracy. We were going to, Well, he never figured out that these aren't things government by itself can solve. But he tried harder and harder and harder. And he had tremendous sympathy. This man just wore himself out. And, you know, when he was... I always say the entire Democratic convention, riots and all, was financed by Lyndon Johnson's Democratic Party. I mean, he was paying the student loans and tuition of the students rioting in the streets. He was paying Mayor Daley's cops who were unionized, right? He was paying for the civil rights marchers who were joining it at the end. He was paying for the court system that was going to try the Chicago 7, and he was paying for legal aid. This riot is brought to you by LBJ. I mean, there's not a single Republican in this play. There's not a single Republican in this play. I mean, I have no idea what the Republican vote in Chicago was that particular year, but he saw that. Great deal of sympathy. So I can't say any close rapport with a lot. There was close rapport with lots of Democrats. Congressman Alvin Lowenstein, who was an anti-war leader. Buckley breaks ranks to support somebody he doesn't agree with on anything for a seat in Congress because smart people need to be in Congress. That was the argument. And the Republican Party says, are you out of your mind? We just elected your brother on the Conservative Party ticket. He's now running for re-election on the Republican line. Next to Lowenstein's opponent, this is what you always wanted, and you're still not happy. So we had that's your my bill. So we had these kind of things. And great friendships with people like Galbraith and Norman Mailer and many, many, but not presidents, but great sympathy for Johnson. Because he saw the human dimension there. He saw with Shakespearean, he saw Lear. And he was quite a fit. He did get very close to Humphrey at one point. It's not a long story, so I'll just weave it in. Humphrey says, during all of these disturbances, well, if I was young and unemployed, I could eat one hell of a rat myself. Well, so Buckley says, writes Colin, shouldn't a vice president be on the side of law and order instead of encouraging people to do? So that's not what I meant, Bill. So Buckley writes him a letter, and Humphrey says, well, instead of attacking me all the time, why don't you sit down and come up with a positive agenda that you and I can work on. Bingo, Buckley's now on the phone, won't the vice president see me? Wow. So the letters go back and forth about how they're gonna have this meeting without Humphrey's staff finding out about it, maybe without your magazine finding out about it, maybe without the Conservative Party, and they had a ball, right? They had a ball. Now, I don't think they solved anything, but Rosen, I don't think, listed the Humphrey eulogy in his book of obituaries. I mean, Buckley wrote maybe 250 wonderful obituaries to the greats of his time. And you know, Rosen only gave you like 20% of them, but they're wonderful. And the one on Humphrey, you see the great affection that's coming out there, the human being in Hubert Humphrey. And he's a typical liberal. We're trying to watch a film. You think that VCRs are out of date. And we're trying to watch some film. I don't know what the film was. And the projector's wrong. It says, Uncle Hubert is now under the hood, right? Uncle Hubert with his wrenches. And, you know, Hubert, we're going to land in a half hour. It's a two-hour film. Stop already. That's your liberal. They won't admit nothing works. It's a wonderful, wonderful tribute to him. Okay.
Yeah. As you can tell, Al knows a lot about Bill Buckley. But thanks so much, everyone, for being here. If there's an institution that Buckley loved after the church and National Review, it was Yale.
Oh, yes.
So again, he'd be completely delighted that all of you are here. Al, thanks for catalyzing this program at the beginning, and congratulations on the book.
Thank you. And thank you. And thank you for what you do every day. You know, Bill had many things, but he was prouder of nothing more than National Review.
Thank you.
And I know he did pick you to be editor. You had the moxie to ask for it. I'm sure he liked that a lot. Pay attention, right? Ask for it, right? Don't wait for people to find you. Lincoln said that. He said young men and women should not wait to be brought forward by older people. You've got to advance yourself. And he liked that. But more than that, you show tremendous courage. He's looking down, smiling at you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Al. Thanks, okay. Everyone. Thanks, Al. That was very
hey,
sweet.
Thank you.
I appreciate that. That was great.